Welcome to Catalyst, a podcast by De Facto Community Center Project.
One, two, three. In 1649, St. Rosendale, a ragged band they called the Diggers came to show the people's will. They defied the landlords, they defied the laws. Dispossessed, reclaiming what was theirs. We come in peace, we did so. We come to work the land in common and to make the wasteland grow. Instead of dividing, we will make whole. So we will be a common treasury for all. The sin of property, we do disdain. No man has any right to buy or sell the earth.
Systematic imposition on common owned property and ever increasing restrictions of public land access to the public. So both, you know, this mass amount of land that used to be commonly held by the people to be foraged, hunted, and cultivated, basically being snatched up by, and this is, you know, centuries ago, by the aristocracy, the church, the government, and kind of now we're just seeing these, the residuals. We have like little plots of public land, like little parks and forests and stuff. But ever increasingly, they're being opened up to drilling, they're being opened up to lots of bad environmental stuff, yet also ever increasing restrictions of public access to them. So to begin, just to talk a little bit more about who the Diggers were, it's very, very brief history. So again, it was a common held property that people foraged, hunted, and cultivated to help supplement their very meager incomes. But again, a lot of this land was snatched up by the church, snatched up by the aristocracy. So a bunch of people, they were first called the True Levelers, which was a bit of a mock of this political party that was called the Levelers, who were like, kind of like the Democrats, who were like, they say things, but then don't always do them.
Levelers?
So, yeah, this is the Levelers. And so these guys were like, no, we're the True Levelers. Like, so they just took everything a step further, and a big part of what they were wanted was this communal ownership of at least large plots of land.
Is this like the 1600s?
Yes, this is the 1600s. For specifically the Diggers. I mean, obviously these issues have gone on all over the world at different times, but for the Diggers it was this time. So a bunch of these guys were like, they were later kind of nicknamed the Diggers because they took over St. George's Hill, which is mentioned in the song, and all the other places too, but that was like the first one that they took over, and just started like tilling and cultivating the heck out of it to, you know, help basically provide food for themselves and the people. And even though this was still like public land, technically, This wasn't owned by anybody in particular. It was still part of what was left of the commons. The landlords were like, we don't like this. These people are going to, like, grow their own food and they don't have to buy it from us. Like, no, not cool. So the landlords basically were, like, calling the police or whoever you called at that time. Well, not calling, I guess, because it was the 1600s. But you know, no cell phones then. So the diggers were all arrested. And then even though they couldn't figure out anything to charge them with, the justice was like, no, I'm just going to keep you in jail because I can. So that was rude and horrible. But so then, skipping to 1932, just jumping ahead a few centuries, and in the New World. So the Bonus Army was a group of World War I vets. And again, this was during the Great Depression. So they were not doing well. Neither was really almost anyone. So they were not given the bonuses that they were promised by the government. So after, you know, doing who knows what to try to get their bonuses to just help alleviate their suffering, they were like, well, the government doesn't care and isn't listening, so we're just going to go take over D.C. So they set up this encampment, you know, much like we've seen with lots of other groups since. But this is one of the earlier examples in America. So they came and set up basically like a shanty town. You know, they had all the things that they needed, people cooking, people taking care of whatever needs there were. I mean, these were like vets, you know, like they knew what they were doing. They knew about survival. They knew how to build a bloody fire. So,
like a rainbow gathering?
Yeah, exactly like that. Exactly like that.
This is right before the Depression?
This is right, well, it was like during the Depression. Oh, so right. After World War II, or after World War I, before World War II. So it was 1932. So they camped out in front of the mall of Washington, D.C. And of course, the government, they were there for a while. Actually, off the top of my head, I didn't write it down exactly how long they were there. But after a while, the government sent the army to kick them all out and light everything, all of their stuff on fire.
Holy shit.
So this was literally an army being like, oh, hey, look, this is going to be us in like 40 years. Let's light them on fire. Which I can't really wrap my mind around, because it was one thing if it was like the police or like a different branch of, I don't know, the armed services, but this was literally people looking at their future and being like, I'm sure when I'm old like you, the government will treat me better, so I'm just going to do what they tell me now. I don't know. It's really hard to imagine how they could have justified that to themselves.
Following orders, right?
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly. So then, jump ahead to 1968, the Poor People's Campaign, which was, Martin Luther King, Civil Rights Movement, which eventually he started transitioning. Obviously, you know, he was also opposed to the Vietnam War and all those things, but part of his, like, kind of diversification of his issues that he was advocating for, he worked together with a lot of other groups to form the Poor People's Campaign, which is basically this very diverse group of people from all different ethnicities and backgrounds, but who are all suffering in impoverished conditions, got to empower them and bring them all together to fight for a better economic situation. So it didn't get enacted, unfortunately, until after Martin Luther King died, although he was a huge part in the planning stages. They called it Resurrection City. It lasted for 6 weeks, again, on the Washington, D.C. Mall. 6 weeks, they had like a medic station and a general store and like all the little things you'd find in like a little city. But after 6 weeks, it was cleared by the police. Then jump to 2011. Now there's definitely a lot of other examples in between these. I'm just grabbing some highlights. But 2011, we're a little bit more familiar with Occupy Wall Street. Again, it was a weird thing too, because the park that Occupy Wall Street was in, the Zuccotti Park, was like technically privately owned, but because of like some of the skyscrapers that got built around it, like their deal with the city was like, if we allow you to build this really tall building, you have to provide an open space that's accessible to the public 24/7. So that was kind of part of the deal to let them build this like really big building or something like that. So technically it was private land, but it was had to be by law open to the public 24/7. So that was the Zuccotti Park where Occupy Wall Street was set up. And of course we all know what happened there. They were there for a few months, 3 or 4 months? I can't off the top of my head remember. But was then again very violently shut down by the police, and then subsequently internationally all the Occupy movements were shut down. So then there was 2016, Standing Rock. Again, the actual encampment for like the Sacred Stone encampment is actually on private property, but you know they have been, when they go out to protest like the developments and where they're trying to do construction on the pipeline, then that's sorry, pardon me, going off the private land where the encampment is on, which is where they've been getting arrested. So first, I'd just like to say, like, how absurd is the notion that an indigenous person in this country can ever be arrested for trespassing? To me, is a little, stupid, for lack of a better term. It's a huge, that's a much better term, hypocrisy.
Well,
yeah. So, you know, when we're seeing how they're being handled by the police as well, not particularly nicely. So this kind of just leads us to the question of, like, well, I mean, what? Do we now protest by just standing in our front yards with a sign? Like, we can't do it on public property or we get shut down by the police, so how are we supposed to do this? How are we supposed to redress our grievances to the government if we can't even access, you know, public property to do so?
What about, like, a podcast or something?
Maybe somebody should work on that.
Good idea.
This kind of led to the start of kind of what we dreamed for De Facto. So, you know, I've been actively involved in the community for a long time, and sometimes it can be really difficult, just logistics of things. And one of my friends was like, "You need a building." I was like, "I need a building." And that kind of developed into a much more well-developed plan, but that's kind of eventually how it started, because we need a place where we can come together and do these things and organize and plan events and hold events and meetings and storage space and office space, so that we can really come together and organize in a place that we can't be kicked out of. So yeah, you know, every time we try to use public land, you know, we get shut down by the army or by the police. Anytime it builds to the point where we're going to have a real impact. And so during my kind of investigation and research in developing the De Facto Community Center project, I started, like, talking to you fine folks and several other folks who I realized were already kind of trying to do the same things. I mean, a little bit different, which we'll get to you guys in a second. You can explain your specific projects, but all this kind of underlying usage of private property, but to at least at some points open it up for, like, the community benefit. And the benefit of society. So, to briefly talk about De Facto Community Center Project, I have a visual. So, yeah. Thanks, Dana. So, thanks. Oh, again. Yeah, you're tall. Come on. So the De Facto Community Center project is going to be a multi-purpose community center slash drop-in center slash advocacy community service music and art cultural center. So it's going to be everything.
Hey, that was my idea.
You can get to that later. It's not your turn yet. So here would be the... sorry. So let me hit you in the face. So here would be, let's say, the main building. So in the main building, we have, like, some event space. Oops.
Wait for it to fall. Don't grab it.
Sorry.
Fresh so, over here.
We didn't practice this part.
This is not Velcro either. This is, like...
It's felt.
Felt.
Don't point at the flaws in my visual.
Let's don't breathe.
So here we have, the kitchen. We'll have laundry that the public can have access to, showers and bathrooms. A little spot for, like, you know, internet usage, library research, an area that's kind of can function as, like, the cafeteria or also a small event space or small meeting space.
Is this a house or is it, like, a
building? It's a building. It's a building. You know, and it depends. Like, we obviously don't have this yet. We're not anywhere near having the amount of money that we need. So keep that in mind, folks watching this right now. We need your money. Right now we're not sure if we're going to be getting a plot of land and buildings out from scratch, or if we're going to have to retrofit a building and build some accessory buildings. We don't know. So this is kind of like, in my wildest dreams, if we could build it from scratch, this is roughly what it would look like.
What about, like, shipping container village?
That is an absolute possibility, but this plus a lot of the other things that we want to build that are kind of included in this vision, we have some local code issues. So right now it's not legal to have people living in shipping containers. Or living in their RVs or various other things. There's a lot of stipulations in New Paltz and a lot of other places.
So many
it's something
damn rules.
It's there's so many damn rules, yeah. So it's something that we're definitely working on. Which we'll have to get to another podcast because I don't want to keep you guys here till midnight. So then we have, like, let's see, this is kind of our we'll have three-tiered housing. We're going to have the housing for, like, crazy people like me who are going to spend almost all of their time working on this and maintaining this. But then we'll have people who are more like, you know, like woofers who might pass through from anywhere to a few weeks to, like, several months, and then go on their merry way. So we'll have, like, kind of more temporary housing for them. And then we're going to have emergency housing, too. So people who are, you know, there's people who prefer to live outside. You know, call them houseless, call them homeless, whatever you want to call them. They prefer to be called tinkers. They prefer to not
to be called tinkers.
Be housed in the traditional sense, but, you know, sometimes there's rough nights. Sometimes it's just that cold outside or that rainy or whatever, and they just need, you know, or maybe they just rolled into town, or maybe they just lock themselves out of their house and they can't get a hold of their roommates, and they just need a place to sleep because it's in February and they got locked out of their apartment and they forgot their keys or something. Whatever it may be, we don't care. Whatever, you know, they need an emergency place to crash. Sorry, what's that?
Maybe they had a fight with their mom.
Maybe they had a fight with their mom, or their boyfriend, or their girlfriend, or who knows. Yeah, exactly. So temporary housing, first come, first serve, on a 9x8 basis. We're going to have some extra event space that will have, like, two sections, but, like, a removable wall, external storage for, you know, we want to offer our storage and meeting space and office space to other groups in the community. There's a lot of awesome groups in our community who are doing great work. Problem is, they don't have storage space, they don't have office space, they don't have meeting space, so they're trying to hold meetings in, like, cafes where it's, like, loud and they have to work around their hours of operation, and there's not enough seating for everybody, and they have to buy stuff. So it's not terribly ideal. And then sometimes, like, their materials are in, like, five different people's houses. So if they're having an action or an event, and they have to get all this stuff from, like, five different people's houses in one place at one time, it can be really difficult if you don't have a nice, like, main headquarters area. So we want to have, like, an extensive garden to feed as many people with it as possible, both people who live and reside with us at DeFacto Community Center, or people who are just in the community and want to come and get a vegetable. We're gonna have kind of camping and tent space for, you know, people who want to camp out in tent. If they already have an RV or a tent and would rather stay in that than in our temporary housing, that's cool too. A parking lot. So, in no particular order, and certainly not to proportion. Pretend this green area is roughly 3 acres. I think it's kind of our ideal, what we're looking for. And the buildings are not quite proportionally to size. But that's, you know, kind of roughly what we would ideally have. All right, I'm going to get this out of your face now. Hey, stop talking about me behind my visual.
I'm telling them what you were doing. I'm
going to need a recap after.
You couldn't see anything.
Okay. So we're just going to get this out of the way. Thank you for your patience. So, next, I just want to talk a little bit about where, can you breathe? I want to talk a little bit about where we are. So right now we're in, well, the People's Cauldron is on one side, which is an apothecary, and then on this side it's the bookstore, which I think the name is changing soon, but it's the bookstore attached to the apothecary on Main St Rosendale. 430 Main St in Rosendale.
Very cool spot, lots of sci-fi. Mm-hmm. Sci-fi.
A little bit of horror, and then the classics.
Star Trek.
Mystery thrillers.
So the bookstore / apothecary is, one, kindly hosting our filming of this podcast, so thanks to them for that. But I also just want to highlight, they're also kind of one of our examples tonight. Even though it is a private business, Sarah publicly posts in her kind of alcove coming into her store that if anybody has any legitimate medical needs but isn't really in a financially sound situation, that she can help work something out with them. So she, you know, she doesn't want anybody being denied, like, traditional herbal care just because they are having trouble affording it. So there's that. Also, since she helps DeFacto all the time, she sells our products here that we're selling to raise money for our community center for free. She takes no commission. She also just, like, donates, like, all the time, even when I try not to let her. Also has held several collection days for Standing Rock, both collecting money, collecting supplies, and also took money out of her own pocket to send the supplies via mail. Also sent them a ton of specific herbs and herbal remedies that they were asking for when they put a call out to the herbal community. Tons of herbs and teas that she sent out to them. And now currently is collecting money for the ACLU. So she is very much both herself utilizing this space for the community and also inviting other people to come utilize the space for the community. So that's something that should be recognized. And also just letting people know that there's awesome people doing awesome stuff. So now we're gonna just kind of go down the line and each of you guys can talk about your things, your projects.
Well, yeah, thank you, Amanda. Definitely a local hero.
Yeah.
I can't believe you cook all those meals at Food Not Bombs. So, yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you for having me here. It's an honor to be here with all y'all. So, my name is Jens. My project that I'm involved with is Deer Creek Herb Farm, Deer Creek Collective. It's a community homestead where right now 4 people are living. And we have a mission. We're developing our mission. Right now it reads, what does it say? What we're doing is we're committed to growing respect, cultural awareness, cultural respect for land and people. So we do that by hosting events and having skill shares and having parties and yeah, so we're an intentional community, and there's an herb farm there, which the plan for the herb farm is to subsidize our existence there, so paying the taxes and paying the different expenses that are associated with being on that land, and also to provide high quality medicinal and culinary herbs for the community, And it's also it's a seedbed for other projects to rise out of. So yeah, whatever different things might happen there, either massage practices or different cottage industries that are so yeah, it's I like to think of it as a seedbed pun intended for different things that'll be community resources. So yeah, it's
where are you guys?
It's an Accord.
Oh, an Accord. Right.
Yeah.
How many do you have there? How much room is there?
There's
2 separate questions.
Well, there's 4 people and, yeah, room to grow more. Seasonally. I mean, having different people there through different times of the year. Right now there's just 4 warm places to be. But in the summer, this is our 3rd year there. It's going to be our 3rd year, so yeah, we kind of
4 separate dwellings, or is that 4 like roommates?
It's roommates. It's everybody's sharing like one living space. Cool. Yeah, and it's beautifully preserving food in the fall. Now we're eating out of our freezer and out of our root cellar.
Nice.
Yeah, sharing meals together, having a weekly meeting to talk about plans and have share meals together. So there's many layers of community that are growing there. There's the central community, and then there's the other rings of community. It's very much in support of community and supported by a community. The reason why we're doing is so that people can come there and have these experiences, and if people weren't coming there and being a part of it, then we wouldn't
Like a rental
property. Yeah.
How long have you guys been doing it?
So this is gonna be our third season there. Yeah.
Do you guys all work on the herb farm? Is it like a group effort, or do the people have jobs?
People right now have jobs, outside jobs. But the intention is to grow the herb farm that it can support more people, that it can employ 3 to 4 people, and then hopefully create other sources of employment on the land, so we don't have to go travel other places for.
You guys all own it together, or is this just one person?
No, I'm the owner right now.
Okay.
And part of the future vision is to to create land security, because there's no right now. It's just my good intention to stay there.
Yeah.
If I move to Brazil or something, or die, then there's then that kind of ends its existence. But similarly to other land projects, that I've been a part of and that I see around. There's, you know, land security when it's privately owned is a big, it's a big challenge to work with because you don't know how long you're going to be there, and then yeah, it changes always, the way you interact yeah, with that land.
Trust.
Yeah, so having a, you know, good relationship with the landlord is one thing, or the owner, but that's also only going to take you so far. So we're in talks with some people, Joan and Wilton in particular, are spearheading this. I know there's a legendary permaculture couple in the Hudson Valley here, and we're wanting to develop some sort of customized local land trust. So that we can create land security for these different types of community
there's always
lands.
Like legal like loopholes, or like if you can set yourself up to be like a church or something, or a non-profit, not-for-profit.
Yeah.
There's all these things, you know, that people...
And really exploring the idea of land ownership and how, you know, we can follow that the traditional land trust model where, you know, we can buy, sell off development rights and that sort of thing and lower the value of the land. But also maybe just looking at different ways of what land ownership means and thinking outside the box and really, you know, banding together as a community to secure these lands. So that's in the works. It's very in its early stages, but awesome. That's a big part of the mission, yeah.
Awesome.
So.
Oh, that's so exciting. I guess you boys, check a whistle.
All right, so... I guess like 2 years ago, I bought a house in Kingston, just a rundown multifamily house, and we fixed it up and moved into it, and the house next door was abandoned too, so I was able to get that house the next year, and so there's these two houses that are side by side. They're both big multifamily houses.
Is this in Midtown?
Yes, in Midtown.
Henry Street.
So.
Oh wow.
So I took the fence down between the two yards and have this big, huge, you've been there, right?
No,
it's like it's a very big yard for a city, lot. It's two big, very big city lots. And, there's like a big, big area for gardens. And,
you took down the middle fence when you bought the other one?
I took down the middle fence. So it's just one big open. And, so basically I have a whole bunch of apartments, which like is kind of like a semi-attentional community, you know? the prototype that I have is that like everyone has their own separate living space, you know, they have their own kitchen and their own bathroom, and so I'm taking the whole first floor of the second house and basically going to open it up into a big like hall kind of community center. And I already put in like a commercial kitchen, commercial style kitchen with the three base sinks. And
Kingston food, not bombs.
Yeah. So I'm basically just assembling like a space, you know, putting together a space that can be multi-purpose. It's gonna be kind of like a yoga or dance studio type space, you know. And then there's a kitchen. So I imagine definitely doing like classes, martial arts, yoga, all those things. But it's all going to be like donation based. So this is like, you know, it's in a residential area, and I didn't, you know, do anything with like codes or emergency exits and fires and all this stuff. So I'm just going to
ask for forgiveness, not permission.
Exactly. Yeah.
Don't talk about it on the internet.
Well, people are just going to be, it's going to be basically just private events, you know, private parties and things, and people can get together, we can have study groups, can like, you know, study, you know, the types of things that you guys are working on, you know, people could just get together and do those things, can cook food, you know, try to get a licensed kitchen in there, and so maybe you can make, you know, herbs or, you know, cookies.
Or herbal cooking.
So basically, and then the whole intention of it, I mean, it kind of just is sort of unfolding, just by itself. Like, you know, there's always kind of been that sort of like the family compound, or you know.
I call it the complex.
Yeah. That's always been something that's.
Yeah. Who lives there right now?
Me, Theo, my mom. Rick, Michael, Justin, and Timmy.
I'm not going to give out last names.
Just
friend, like mostly just friends, you know, that found out that he had a rental that, you know, we just fixed up and looks really good, and so, all right, yeah, move in. It's nice to have your friends around, as you know.
Yeah,
but it's kind of in the beginning stages, so more and more is, like, once that, the community center space is still under construction, but I should have that up and running next, by, before next year, and once that happens, you know, then all the kind of chemistry, the, you know, it'll all come together, you know, because all right now, all these people are just living, and, you know, we see each other once in a while outside and hang out, but there's not, like, this, like, you know, community thing happening as much yet, but once we all, once the common space is there, it's gonna really, you know.
Awesome.
But,
I'm excited
it.
About that too. I need to go there at some point. I miss every party, everything.
Yeah.
Because I'm lame and I'm just out in the fields, just being covered in dirt all
just
day.
Just twiddling your thumbs.
Just gardening.
We're gonna need some people to get involved in the gardens. It's actually one of the things I want to, you know, explore is that urban gardening and maybe do some vertical stuff, like try to really max out the whole space to have like maximum yield. And then with the kitchen, you know, we could have like cooking classes or like you could do something where
food
you
food preservation
can yeah just sort of, you know, you get some people to sign up, they want to learn some about cooking and permaculture or whatever, and you go out and you pick the food and you prepare it and you eat it, right? It's like a whole thing,
like people,
because a lot of people, they don't have that experience, you know.
Especially not Midtown Kingston.
Not Midtown Kingston.
So. I'd love to donate some herb starts.
Oh, cool.
Yeah,
nice.
Time comes,
yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Networking.
Networking, yeah.
Creek, you want to?
Yeah. I'm Creek Iverson. I'm the farmer and director of Seed Song Farm and Center, which is newly named and relocated right in Kingston, New York, also.
Nice.
Yeah. And I have to say, I know Amanda pretty well from working on the same farm with her this past year, and she is a hardcore kick-ass worker. She's not just spouting this stuff off like intellectually, philosophically. She like has her hands in the ground, and it's really, I'm really delighted to see this project taken off with such a hardworking person. And I also need to say that we still have chickens that Jens gave us in 2013. Those are the frickin' most survivor chickens. So they had like a really good life. Some of them live in Rosendale now at the Bermanzons. So I thought I would tell you that. You probably didn't know.
Yeah,
so how long have you guys known each other?
I don't know, probably 2013 or so.
Oh, wow.
Since the chickens.
Chicken incident of 2013.
Yeah.
No, prior to the chickens. We find when you were at Brook Farm and I was at Tweed, yeah.
Right, so it was early in 2013.
Yeah.
So that's a good segue into, you know, I'm a farmer without land. And that's been a really grueling project for the last 10 years. When I first joined a CSA that had a heavy social justice component and became a barter share CSA member, that was the start of my farming career, and I switched over from being an environmental educator, activist, and teacher of natural sciences and music, and saying, oh, this farming, community farming thing is really how to get people to realize what's special about their natural resources and kind of build a reverence for it, which is, I think, what our culture is basically lacking right now, is making stupid land decisions, because as kids, we don't necessarily have the freedom to really interact properly and with freedom in the land anymore, which I was lucky enough to have growing up in Otsego County, and I wish that for all kids, and that's a part of what our farm project is, I think. But so I've farmed in 5 different places since in that 10 years, which means that I haven't been at any farm longer than a couple of years. And so now this new project, I do have basically a forever lease, 30-year renewable lease. So as long as the business works, it's the rest of my life, and that's a big blessing.
Okay.
You know, it's hard to find a model, I think, within our capitalist structure and with the cost of food devalued the way it is by, you know, fossil fuel production and big ag, to really make it as a farmer and still meet like a triple bottom line where you're serving the community in different ways too. And I know I can tell you 100 farmers who will tell you the same thing. It is very, very hard. So so we basically split our model into an LLC farm and a 501c3 not-for-profit center, which conducts good community work, social justice work, education work, good events like arts events to attract people to the land around the farming. And I feel pretty confident that we finally have a winning strategy after going through like trying to work with landowners who had a lot of money and had a nice farm and wanted someone to farm it, to not-for-profit organizations, which both had their pluses and minuses, but this is kind of a hybrid model that I hope works. Anyway, the founding, I guess the main thing, the farm itself is an agroecological farm. That's like agroecological farming is kind of what happened in Cuba when the Soviet Union fell apart and wasn't able to provide them with like good tractors and farm equipment anymore. And Cuba basically had to redesign its way to feed itself. And it went to a smaller scale, organic, community participatory method of farming, which is still a pioneer and something that a lot of people, a lot of farmers in our country are now going to try to learn more from and figure out. So in addition to the basic vegetable, herb, berry farm and cut flowers, we also are adding forest products to the mix, and part of it will be a community forest garden where we have plantings of things so that during our educational programs and even the public themselves can come to the farm and experience foraging, or you know, go and pick blackberries and then come back to our kitchen and make jam or something like that. You know, very direct experiences where they're like, they're doing it, and they're, and it's kind of a full loop circle. For example, right now I have winter rye and two kinds of winter wheat in the ground that are for a local bread baker in Kingston. I don't know if you guys know John's Bread. Really awesome, high quality bread he sells right outside the old Dutch church.
Yeah,
it's like Scandinavian rye bread. It's just one slice and you're good for the rest of the day.
You don't want to drop it on a bunch.
Yeah. It's heavy, dense stuff. So we're growing that grain as a trial for his bread. He's going to bring his bread oven to the farm, and it'll be a pizza oven as well, like other farms have had success with. And then that'll be a whole community event we can add to our matrix of ways to entice people to come experience growing together.
Well, is that a business deal? Like, did he buy the wheat and give you money to plant it?
We're still working it out. One of many collaborations that we're trying to push forward.
Grain's
in the ground, and I'm going to give it to him one way or the other. I don't know what the barter or exchange will be yet. I guess it's really important that especially our center is collaborating with all these different groups to move the mission forward. And the basic mission is to develop this improved sense of stewardship, public stewardship for the land, this reverence I talked about, and it's based on the way the Native Americans grew. In the winter of 2012, we hooked up with the two-row wampum people who were doing a paddle down the Hudson River to celebrate a 400-year-old treaty between the Dutch and the local Native Americans. It was the Iroquois, I think, actually. And it was called the two-row wampum treaty because basically the wampum depicted these two straight lines going down the river, and it represented the Native American culture and the European culture coexisting side by side, doing their own thing, collaborating, friendly or not, but being able to keep their cultures moving forward independently. And of course, the treaty was broken a million times since then. But the founding principles, you know, that group has now met quasi-monthly at our farm since that time, since 2013. Wherever our farm was, they've used it as a place to have their ceremonies, to plant a Three Sisters planting, which has been as much as half an acre of corn, beans, and squash interplanted in the Native American tradition, the local Osogas people. And so now, in this new situation, we're able to really up that We have land along the Esopus Creek. It's 214 acres that four farmers share, so I have about 30. And we have some land along the Esopus Creek, which is being developed as that Three Sisters patch with a canoe kayak launch, a wigwam, and little, like, kind of recreated encampment. And that's for kind of bringing this traditional wisdom back. And the mission of this group that we collaborate with, Nitap Hitap, is to take traditional native ways and use them as solutions to contemporary problems. So we feel like this is like a perfect example of keeping that moving along. So that's one collaboration and one really like founding principle of the farm that we're trying to create. And there's two others, so I realize I've gone on a while, so I'll try move it forward. A second one is we're collaborating with the New African Roots Library in Rondout, which is bringing to underserved communities a local library and a dose of African American culture. So we have a program exchange that's going. They actually have their opening on the 18th. From 1 to 4, if anybody wants to go check it out.
In the Rondout or the farm?
It's in Ponkapi.
Okay.
But there'll be cross-programming. And I'm helping like set up their space, and they've been helping to do outreach for me. So a second kind of founding theme is Martin Luther King's beloved communities, and that's brought by, our board member, Bill Winfield, is the founder of the African Roots Library in Kingston, and he also 15 years ago founded the same kind of library in Poughkeepsie. So he's got really deep.
Is that the one at Duchess Outreach?
Yes. Oh no, it's at the Family Partnership.
Right. It's Duchess Outreach is in the family.
Next door. And then finally, the third influence was Pete Seeger and the Clearwater, which is why I moved to the Hudson Valley to work on that. And there was an example of that was again like a public immersion in your natural resources, where every kid in the Hudson Valley at some point has like pulled fish out of the river and touched them or learned the water chemistry or helped steer the boat or pull up the sail. It was a very immersive, holistic experience that basically has turned around the way that people think about the Hudson River and care for it. So we kind of think our farm is like, if Clearwater was a tractor, it would be what we're trying to do on the land. And the other part of that is, along with the, Pete also followed this Native American model of having food-based ceremonies and celebrations. So we have a monthly, the Strawberry Festival, the Maple Syrup Festival, whatever it is. There's some get-together all the time that allows people to both, they've participated in the growing and maybe the weeding and the work of the growing, and now they're participating together in the celebrating and in growing the culture around that celebrating. Whether it's having a farmhouse concert, we even had Pete play at our farm when we were in New Paltz, which was pretty awesome. But we have different musicians come. We had a kite festival. We had a puppet show in the cornfield. So by bringing the arts to the farm again, that's kind of like our lore to attract all these different communities to like a vital communitarian experience on the farm. I guess I'll just end it in my little spiel by saying that the farm doesn't have much infrastructure. It's a fantastic farm. It was in fact the first patented farm in Kingston. It was part of the old Chambers farm, which Thomas Chambers was this Scottish guy who got the first farm patent. So it's like good farmland. It's all in floodplain, but that means we've got Catskill Mountain silt that's been replenishing it regularly. So it's really good farmland. On the other hand, there's like very little infrastructure for the events-based thing and meal-based program that we're trying to pull off. So thinking about your kitchen is very exciting. Yeah. And
so maybe building a cob house or some kind of building structure there, like infrastructure meaning like housing and.
Right now there's an old farmhouse we're renovating, and I have a 3,000 square foot greenhouse that I put up that we're going to be multi-purpose. It'll have the seedlings in the spring, but half of it will still be for bringing the programs in, so we have a place out of the rain if we need to. But then we're developing these other things, an outdoor stage, like in the middle of nowhere on the farm, where even though our location is like right outside the city of Kingston, like near the IBM Tech Center and all the shopping malls on Route 9. Uh-huh. So it's crazy, and there's a bus stop right near it, and we're near the Ulster County Social Services Building. So we have like this high potential to get people there, and yet it's a 214-acre beautiful farm with the Catskill Mountains in the background.
I'm trying to picture where it is.
Soil.
Wow.
Sopus Avenue, you know where the thrift store is? Salvation Army thrift store on Ulster Ave?
Yeah.
That intersection is the Sopus Ave. So you turn off there and you'll find it. A couple blocks
that's
you'll
amazing.
Find it. Yeah, it's pretty crazy. I guess I should stop talking now. The ways to connect with the farm, we have CSA as low as $17 a week, pretty traditional. We also offer work exchanges and hopefully some complete barter shares if we raise enough money so that people who don't have means can participate in that. And then we have community harvest suppers, which are open to anybody. Just come to the farm, do something to help, whether it's bring food, help pick green beans for 2 hours or whatever, and then we all cook and eat some of that food together. And that's been just a really wonderful way to extend our farm community, not to mention the events I spoke about. And if you have a community group that wants a program at the farm, we're getting those going immediately with a backyard sugar tapping exercise in February.
Awesome. Come in.
All right.
So in case people didn't all catch that, who might be watching with a pen and paper, we're going to put all of the contact for all of you and your projects up at the end so people can kind of follow up if they're interested in joining in any of these things.
You're good.
You're
very smart. This is the way.
That's what they don't pay me for.
Right.
That'd be awesome. We'll get all of your contact information. Whoa, suddenly words don't work. We'll get your contact information, websites, anything that you want to put up. We'll get put up at the end, and then people can kind of follow up on the awesome stuff that you're working on. So I just have a couple of questions. Some of you kind of have partly answered some of these anyway, so I'll just kind of like say the question and anybody can kind of jump in. We'll go into this one. So if anyone watching this right now is super excited by everything that we're all doing and wants to participate or help in any way, what ways could they help in your project? Like, do you need farm volunteers? Do you need, you know?
I always want people coming by to get involved. Yeah, I mean, it's there for that, for people to come and experience the land. Similarly to, I think, all of our projects, like, come out and participate.
Together, work on something together.
Any specific, skill sets? Or, you know, like, for example, you guys are still kind of working on putting people who were like yoga instructors
people
would be interested
if anyone who has some kind of something they want to teach, like yoga or anything at all, really, they can contact me and talk about putting together a class, and then just be basically by donations.
And you're doing kind of like skill workshops and stuff too, right, Ian, at your farm? Like doing...
We were developing our calendar. We're starting off with a maple syrup, pancake, lunch, March, and then, do like garlic planting. We have different, throughout the season, mushroom inoculation. If somebody wants to host something, that's always,
cool.
So it's something, welcome.
And you had kind of mentioned some things, but do you want to kind of reiterate some of the like stuff that you got coming up that people can be involved with?
Yeah. Well, I guess I'll say we're enough of a scale that like if a whole college group or high school group wants to come, that's awesome. You know, we keep that as part of the center's work, the nonprofit work, so they might help with the Native American garden or getting up a space for community events. Those are the kind of things that, I have a SUNY group coming next week, actually. Mm. And so we welcome that, and it's usually a good time for people. people think of farming work as drudgery, but like for me, I think it saved my life at one point, and it's very therapeutic, outdoors, getting exercise, good people, good food, people chatting and, communing. It really can't be beat, actually. Mm. So,
It makes me think of homeschooling. There's a big homeschooling community in Hudson Valley. One of the people that live at our house is a homeschooler. Hmm. And I have a 10-year-old son that I desperately want to
somehow shift into homeschooling. But I mean,
nice.
Can't imagine that not going to a garden as a homeschooler and working. I don't know if that's
That would be a good experience. I just spoke at something in Woodstock. It was like a Pioneers and Woodstock Land Conservancy series, and there I did hook up with a Woodstock homeschooling group. Homeschooling, that too. You keep your school at home. We're on the farm. So hopefully they'll be,
they'll
be coming down.
That makes sense. Yeah. That's a good connection.
So I guess the rest of my questions you guys have kind of really already answered mostly. So I guess what I'll just say, is there anything else that any of you want to say or share or ask each other or anything?
Well, for me, it just, I see like all of our individual kind of projects as like almost like meridian points on a bigger thing. So
network.
Like my whole, you know, kind of in my imagination, I see like these, you know, at least for what we're doing is like we're becoming able to establish ourselves and kind of root ourselves so that we can, you know, so that we can reach out to all these other people and all these other networks and create a stronger, bigger network.
We're stars of the same constellation.
So that's what I'm really excited about is, you know, like you said, like maybe, you know, maybe you guys need a kitchen to do something in, or maybe you need a...
I can edit out part.
You know what I mean?
All right.
Yeah. That'd be great.
Yeah.
Do like a barter, vegetables for kitchen use.
Yeah. And you guys could come and teach us how to build like, you know, farm tower, growing tower.
Oh, vertical tower?
Vertical, yeah. You know, for
you might have to teach me. That's the deal.
Yeah.
Okay, I can't not acknowledge the fact that, you know, we got cut off. So, battery ran out. So now we're going to wrap this up. So does anybody else want to make any...
Yeah, I just want to acknowledge that, you know, I think we're all part of a greater cultural movement, and we're gonna be supporting each other through this, and it's an awesome time to be doing what we're doing.
And an awesome place to be doing it.
Yeah.
You know, the Mid-Hudson Valley here on the Western Shore, it's like, it's just crazy how many people are social, you know, active with social justice or with new growing things and community endeavors. It's really kind of fun.
It is. And I feel like, sometimes I feel like the more conservative the administration that we're under, the more radical the grassroots is, which is cool because a lot of people kind of get, after like waking up from an 8-year nap, start to kind of, and especially now there's all this great stuff to jump into, I'm feeling very hopeful about the future.
That's awesome.
And I feel like our generation is so, and you know, maybe it's just, you know, where we are in like history and what we've seen in our lives in the world so far, but I feel like our generation is just so much more community oriented. Like even people who are like, yeah, I'm gonna get a successful business and I'm gonna do this and I'm gonna get this house and I'm gonna get this whatever, but like everybody, but there's always still that social component, like, oh yeah, I'm gonna go buy a farm, but I'm also gonna like have this group come and like do some social justice, or like, oh, I'm gonna own this apothecary, but I'm gonna like send free herbs to Standing Rock to, you know, kill the pipeline.
It's kind of it's like a shift that people could make.
Yeah.
Like even with like the place that, you know, like I just bought a house. It's not even a big deal, but anyone could buy a rundown house and turn it into whatever they want.
Yeah, but you're like, and I'm going to make this community room.
Right.
Yeah. So, like, our generation is just, like, everything that we do, we're seeing how we fit into the greater community and how we can be part of something that just benefits everyone. And that's really awesome.
I think little, like, clusters of, you know, people. And then if we can connect, then we can be really powerful.
Absolutely. And I see all of us as part of, like, we were kind of saying, like, stars in the same constellation. Like, we're all groups that are going to be aware of each other's activities and like be helping, you know, sharing resources or sharing solutions to problems, sharing skills, and we're all just going to be part of the same kind of extended family, even though we're in different locations.
The exciting thing is that there's people already doing all this stuff all over the place.
And have been for years.
And have been for years, and you just get it.
Or beyond.
Oh yeah.
Connect
yeah.
with them, you know. Once you get established yourself, then you open yourself up to be able to be connecting with all these other people that are doing things.
Absolutely.
To synergy.
To synergy.
Yeah. Together.
All right. So, Again, in a minute, you'll see like the contact information for everybody. So if you want to follow up with any of these awesome people about the great work they were doing and jump in, you'll be able to do that. So for more detailed discussion on public property, private property, this whole thing that I was talking about in the beginning, there's a more detailed article about it entitled Public Property, Private Property, and Its Discontents in De Facto Zine Volume 3. I can't say it's like gonna come out because now or after, because I don't know which is gonna be finished first, this podcast or the zine, but roughly around the same time, look for De Facto Zine Volume 3. It's available at Inquiring Minds Bookstore, Barner Books Store in both in New Paltz, Inquiring Minds and Barner Books in New Paltz. And then also here at the bookstore attached to the People's Cauldron in Rosendale, you can also get our zines here. So yeah, this is a great start to developing, I even wrote it down here. This is a great start to developing a network. Be resources to each other for the benefit of our community and society. Hold on, like, clearly I'm psychic. Or I just knew you guys were awesome. So thanks again for all of you coming and sharing your projects. It's almost like I'm almost overwhelmed with awesome right now.
Yeah.
Cool, but we need your help, so please help us. We can't do this without everybody being involved. Thus concludes.
Is there any like some online networking forum? I mean, no, there has to be that regarding people that are doing similar things. I can think of it.
Well, actually, me and Jens were actually discussing having some sort of like interactive calendar activist thing that would be like super easy to, because like there's like a bunch of like little ones, like this person has an activist newsletter and this person has an environmental newsletter, but there's nothing that's super central and comprehensive for our region. And I think I just found someone who actually has all the computer skills needed but doesn't have the activist connection, so I think our powers combined, that's something that might be coming soon. And if there's already one, I'm certainly not aware of it, which means they're not doing a very good job. So, I mean, there's a lot of ones going on, but they're all kind of tailored to specific groups, and like it's not very central and very so we're working on it. Cool. And I think it would also need to have like a list of all the groups that are doing stuff too and their contact information.
Yeah,
blah 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 blah. So yeah. Coming. All right. Well, thanks everybody.
Facto. Yeah, thanks to that man. Thank you.
Participate.
Applause for all of us. Yay!
This has been Catalyst, a De Facto Community Center project production. For more information, questions, comments, etc., email us at npzdefactoproject@gmail.com. To find out more about De Facto's other current projects and updates, join our Facebook group, NPZ De Facto Community Center Project. To contribute to establishing our community center in or near New Paltz, New York, donate at gofund.me/hmtg6g. Much love and thanks to our special guests, Jens Verhaegh, Charlie and Theo Schikowitz, and Creek Iverson. Their emails are provided to contact them about their projects. Thank you. Please share widely and consider subscribing. Much love from the De Facto Community Center Project.